Hi, my name is Dave Summers. I'm taking you through the Level 3 Award in Supervising Food Safety and Catering and the Level 4 Award in Managing Food Safety and Catering or Manufacturing. The course material is exactly the same, it's just the exam at the end is different. And so the course outcomes, the aim is to improve the supervisory or management of food safety skills of candidates. The learning outcomes, these are the sort of things you will achieve. To provide candidates with sufficient knowledge to enable them to improve the standards and safety of their operation, reduce the risk of food poisoning and food complaints, identify hazards, controls, monitoring and corrective action, interpret the requirements of food level legislation, and to successfully complete a level 3 or level 4 examination. So, let's kick off with the target delegates. If you're doing the level 3 exam at the end of this course, it'll be for supervisory staff and sous and head chefs. Level 4 is for middle and upper management, senior staff responsible for food safety, food hygiene trainers, food course designers, and food business operators. So let's have a look at the course content. So lecture one, we'll start with an introduction to food safety. Lecture two, we'll be covering microbiology. Lecture three, food contamination and control. Lecture four, food poisoning. Lecture five, foodborne disease. Lecture six, personal hygiene and training. Lecture seven, food hazards from purchase to serving. Lecture 8, food spoilage and preservation. Lecture 9, design and construction of food premises and equipment. Lecture 10, cleaning and disinfection. Lecture 11, integrated pest management. Lecture 12, supervisory management. Lecture 13, food safety legislation. So lecture one, we're going to start with an introduction to food safety, and with both these online courses you have access to quite extensive notes that you can download and you can keep by the side of you whilst you're going through these lectures. They'll be at the top of the page. So the aim of this unit, the first unit, is to provide an understanding of the importance of food safety and the role it plays in food hygiene practices. Learning outcomes. By the end of this module, you should be able to define food hygiene, safe food and food poisoning terminology, determine the costs of poor and benefits of good hygiene, and recognise the incidence of food poisoning. So let's have a look at some definitions first of all. Contamination. This is the presence or introduction of a hazard. Now, this could be a microbiological hazard, which you've got there. Could be a food safety physical hazard. When I say food safety, some physical hazards are quite innocuous. Could be a piece of plastic, bit of string. But some could have a food safety hazard problem, such as a sharp screw or piece of glass. Chemicals, that's another type of contaminant, and allergenic chemicals caused by certain foods. So food hygiene, what is that? Well, this is all measures and conditions necessary to control hazards and to ensure fitness for human consumption of a foodstuff, taking into account its intended use. And this is covered by an EC regulation, which I will mention quite often throughout the course, EC regulation number 852/2004. More definitions, a food safety management system. These are the policies, procedures, practices, controls and documentation that ensure the food sold by a business is safe to eat and free from contaminants. HACCP, that's the way we pronounce it, stands for Hazard Analysis Critical Control Points. This is an example of a food safety management system. HACCP is a food safety management system which identifies, evaluates and controls hazards which are significant for food safety. And again, whenever a question comes up on HACCP, it is about food safety, not food quality. And safe food is food that is free from contaminants and will not cause harm, injury or illness. And again, I mentioned on previous courses, you as a customer should be able to go out to any food establishment and eat food that is safe, i.e. it's not going to cause you any type of harm, injury or illness. And as a food handler or a supervisor or manager, you must ensure your staff provide safe food. So making sure that they look after the food to make sure it stays safe. A case of food poisoning. A person with symptoms, usually diarrhea and or vomiting, who has become ill as a result of eating contaminated food and who has provided a specimen from which a food poison organism, toxin or poison, has been isolated or is part of a confirmed food poisoning outbreak. And a carrier, sometimes called a healthy carrier, these are people who excrete food poison organisms or carry them on their body, or in their body rather. There are no symptoms. A convalescent carrier is somebody who's recovered from the illness, and a healthy carrier has never shown any symptoms. Again, it could well be that they're immune from that particular food poisoning organism. And food poisoning, this is an acute illness, and acute means it occurs quickly, could be within 1 hour of ingesting the poison, usually with symptoms of diarrhea and or vomiting. And these are not caused by the poison per se, but by the body's defense mechanism or the immune system. And it's caused by the consumption of contaminated or poisonous food. A multiplication of bacteria usually occurs within the food. So what are the benefits of good food hygiene practices? Well, first of all, you'll have a good reputation for the company. Satisfied customers, which means repeat custom. Increased productivity. Brand protection. Legal compliance. Good working conditions for the staff. Reduced risk of food poisoning. Longer shelf life of product, because part of good hygiene practices is to check dates on food products to make sure they're not coming out of date. And higher staff morale. They're working in good conditions, so you will keep your staff if they're working in a clean environment. And all that leads to safe food means higher profits. So what's the flip side of the coin? What are the costs of poor food hygiene practices? Well, food poisoning could result. Food complaints, brand damage, loss of business, closure, fines and legal costs could run into millions of pounds. Costs of civil action, that's for compensation claims for people that you've possibly made ill as a result of your negligence. Pest infestations, and these bring with them their own diseases, and pests are attracted by unhygienic conditions. Waste food, obviously that comes off the bottom line as far as profit goes. Loss of production. And high staff turnover because of low staff morale working in a dirty environment. So unsafe food means lower profits. So let's have a look at a graph. This is a bar graph of the reported case of food poisoning between 2007 and 2016. And you can see here where figures start quite high in 2007, 72,382. And actually in 2016 it's gone right down to 12,529. So what do you think are the contributing causes of the high numbers of food poisoning? Now, why I mention high numbers didn't look that high, from tens of thousands down to about 12,000, but these are the reported cases of food poisoning. Since 2000, the Food Standards Agency have been sending out questionnaires to UK citizens, asking them if they've had food poisoning and not reported them, as they should do, to either the Environmental Health Department or the local council or to their doctors. And a staggering 15% of people, and this seems to be every year, are saying that they don't report cases of food poisoning. And so instead of tens of thousands down to about 12,000 in 2016, we are talking, if we extrapolate the information to 15% of the population, we are talking about millions, between 12 and 15 million cases of food poisoning every year. So this is why I asked about the high numbers of food poisoning. What do you think are the contributory causes for this? Let's have a look. Intensive farming is one reason, where farmers try to make sure they take their animals to market as quickly as they can to stay in business. So they will feed them processed food, supplemental feeds, and a lot of the supplemental feeds, if they go for the cheapest alternative, they are not sterilized. So any diseases, infections, any parasites within the feed, goes inside the animal systems. Another one, large slaughterhouses and travel stress. Large slaughterhouses, when they slaughter the animals and remove the intestines, there's a lot of splashes and spillages from the intestines, especially in the colon, the large bowel, which contains a lot of food poisoning bacteria or pathogens, and these are splashed onto the clean meat. Travel stress as well increases the amount of potential pathogens within animals before slaughter. There's a lot of more travel now, a lot more imported food. There is more reporting, there's more awareness, although you wouldn't think of it by looking at the graph we looked at. Improved laboratory testing. Testing now is done in a matter of hours rather than days. We eat out more, we eat in convenience food, and the ethnic population of restaurants have increased over the last 30 years. Let's take that last one first. The ethnics, really, it's all about the language barrier, where the people that work in these takeaways and restaurants, their first language is not English, and it's very difficult sometimes to get them onto a food hygiene course in their locality. So they rely on learning information from a book. You can get books translated to many different languages, but it's not the same as going through a food hygiene course as this is. Convenience foods, eating out more. We've got no control over the ingredients that go into that food or by the people that's handling it. More elderly. We are getting a more elderly population, and as I will mention in a few minutes, they are one of the susceptible groups. So they are more susceptible to food poisoning than, adults. The other one of the at-risk groups as well susceptible is the very young. New pathogens are being discovered every time that scientists look into food poisoning problems. They're usually mutations of previous pathogens. Again, new pathogens, new mutations occur because of several reasons, really, because of the amount of chemicals we use to try to kill them. We should be using natural methods, like for example when we wash our hands, use soap and water, don't use chemicals. We tend to use bactericides, we tend to use alcohol gels. These actually make the pathogens stronger. Similarly, the use of chemicals such as antibiotics in animals, this goes into the soil and again makes pathogens stronger. Preservatives, less chemical preservatives are used these days because of the problems that the chemicals cause in our systems. So we tend to use more natural preservatives, such as vinegar, salt, sugar, fats. But these do have an effect in as much as they don't control adequately the pathogen growth. And lastly, fruit and salad pickers, organic vegetables. Look at the first one first. Fruit and salad pickers usually are very poorly paid. They go onto large fruit and salad farms. They pick the salads, the fruit. They probably have the first idea about basic food hygiene. And if they need to go to the toilet, usually the toilets are few and far between. So if they need a dump, they'll go behind a hedge. They'll wipe their ass with a dock leaf. They'll come back out and continue to pick your fruit and salad. Again, this doesn't help because all our fecal contamination is now on the salads and fruits. And organic vegetables, there's always been that argument between organic and inorganic vegetables. The thing is, with organic vegetables, the main source of nutrients for the vegetables is manure. Manure contains a high level of pathogens, so you will get a lot of food safety issues with organic vegetables. This is why it's important to wash them well, peel and wash them well again before you use them. And at-risk groups, these are the groups of people that are more susceptible to food poisoning than other people, and these include the elderly, the very young, ill people or hospital patients, or people who are immunocompromised, such as people on various drug therapies, perhaps cancer therapy drugs, where it reduces the immune system, or perhaps they just had a transplant and they need to be on immunosuppressant drugs. And pregnant women, or rather the unborn child, the fetus, is more affected by bacteria than the pregnant woman.